tell us about how we can verify quantum determinism.
Right, yeah, thank you so much, Andrew. Yeah, thanks for giving me the opportunity to come and to speak. I've really had a great time so far. And today I want to talk about, you know, some line of work that I've been doing during my PhD, which is the question of whether or if so how we can verify quantum sampling schemes and as they are proposed for quantum supremacy. And naturally, this is something that I've worked together with a lot of people on. So there's Martin Schwarz, who used to be a postdoc in the group, Martin Fisch, who has a like junior group in Düsseldorf now, Jens Eisert, of course, Christian Gogolin, and then more recently with Jonas Haferkamp, who's a new PhD student, and Adam and Bill Pfefferman, who you probably know, and Juan Iber Matovega, who's an anchor. Okay, quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is a wonderful theory. It, you know, it produces all these curious phenomena such as superconductivity, superfluidity. There's, you know, the phenomenon of superposition and entanglement. And then what's closest to my heart, quantum mechanics allows you to perform computations that are faster than anything that you can do on a classical computer. Okay, so this is in ideal theory world. Quantum mechanics is a theory, but it's not just a theory. It's a really well-established theory that has been tested a million of times, and you know, it's the best theory that we have of the microscopic world. But how do we go about and test this theory? Why do we know that it's correct? So what we usually do in the scientific method is we do what I call the predict and measure paradigm. So on the one hand, you know, we have a model of some physical system, and you know, we put this model to our computer, you know, we write down a solution of the model, and then we compare the solution of this model to an experiment where we try and really reproduce the precise, you know, the precise nature of this model in a laboratory, or you know, going further to de-idealize this as far as we can to realistic situations. And then, you know, we check whether our predictions that we produce from our model and the data that we gathered in our experiment, whether they match. And if they do, well, you know, we found some confirmation that the quantum mechanics produced the correct prediction, and so that sort of serves to confirm the theory. And if they don't, okay, well, many things have kind of gone wrong, right? So maybe we did something wrong in our experiments, maybe there was some unwanted effect that we didn't model, maybe, I don't know, maybe the theory is just plain wrong. Okay, but you know, this is how we go about, you know, testing specific phenomena. But we can also go about and test more general properties of theory. And the prime example of this is, of course, Bell tests. In Bell tests, we not only test a particular feature or prediction of quantum mechanics, but we test features of the physical world which are, you know, predicted by quantum mechanics, but which people did not believe to be true in the days back then, right? So the phenomenon of non-locality is one like that. And there, you know, we go about in a very similar way. You know, we, you know, ask some question to some parties, which, you know, are experiments if you want, and then we receive responses and we compare to what we expect ideally within the family of theories that we're testing. Okay, and then we can repeat this and, you know, compare some statistical parameter, and if this S parameter is larger than 2, you know, then we have some confirmation that the world cannot be described by local and realistic theories. Okay. Getting a bit confused, I have a new pointer. Okay, so the question I want to ask today is one precisely of this type. Today I want to ask whether quantum speedups, as they are predicted by quantum mechanics, whether they are really physical. And this would be something big in computer science, right? In computer science, we have what's called the computational Church-Turing thesis, which basically states that a classical computer, so a probabilistic Turing machine, can efficiently simulate any realistic model of computation. So any model of computation that we can actually build, you know, physically. We can actually build a machine that does it. Okay, and you know, there's some evidence that this thesis is wrong, right? So we have Feynman's idea of simulating Hamiltonian dynamics, then there's Shor's algorithm for factoring, and more recently we even have a provable advantage for very shallow circuits where, you know, you have a quantum circuit that performs a certain task in constant depth, but every classical circuit requires at least logarithmic depth. So these sort of things serve as evidence that this computational Church Turing thesis is wrong. Again, in the ideal theory world, right? We don't have any of these things in our lab, like on a large scale at the moment. So now when we go down to the lab, you know, things might go wrong, right? We could have some correlations in noise and stuff, which might just destroy any speed up that we predict in our ideal theory. Or maybe, like more generally, quantum mechanics is just plain wrong in this limit of high complexity, right? Where before we asked in the, you know, limit of local, of non-locality, whether quantum mechanics is still true. Now we might ask whether in the limit of high complexity, quantum mechanics is still true. And I refer to this as, you know, something like a computational bell test, right? We still test a general feature of the world, namely whether the world allows for computations that are faster than anything that we can do on a classical computer. Okay, and now, so it's about testing quantum mechanics in this sort of new regime, where, you know, in the predict and measure paradigm, we sort of test quantum mechanics in the local and low complexity limit bell tests, go to the non-local limit, and okay, today I want to look at the high complexity limit. So the regime where we cannot re-simulate on a classical computer. Okay, so how would we go about it? Basically, we do something very similar to a normal experiment, right? So we have some task that we want our experiments, or I don't know, our quantum computer, so something that we have in the lab to do. Then we receive some response. We compare, you know, what we expected, and then we want, you know, green light or red light. Good. Okay. So try number one, of course, is predict and measure paradigm. So we go to our lab. We turn on our quantum computer, then we measure, and we receive some outcome. Okay, and then we try and re-simulate it on our classical computers. But okay, we're in the high complexity limit, so we can't. So this is just gonna fail. We want some test where we can actually certify, right? Where we have a test here, which then gives us green light or red light. Okay, so now there's an example of this, which we might try, which is Shor's algorithm, right? Shor's algorithm has an efficient proof. So we can delegate a computation to the computer, which is, you know, just I give it a large number, and then the Shor algorithm, which is designed to factor this number, and then the computer will give us, you know, the prime factors. And then we can compare, because we can easily multiply the two numbers to get the large number again. And this would be the kind of test that I'm looking for, right? Now, there's some drawbacks with this, namely, you know, to do this, we really need a very large quantum computer to actually go to the high complexity limit. I think, you know, people have demonstrated this for 15. Okay, I can factor 15 in my head. So maybe this really doesn't count as verifying in the high complexity limit. Not only do we want a task that, you know, we expect to scale up very badly, but we also want to go to that regime where it's really hard for the computer. And then, you know, a second minor drawback to some extent is that, you know, we don't really have a rigorous hardness argument for Shor's algorithm. Of course, everyone believes that factoring is hard, and our cryptography is based on that. But maybe we want something a bit stronger. Yes. Yeah, please. Exactly. So, I mean, So when I mean no rigorous hardness argument, I mean, we want to find the most solid foundation for these sort of tests that we can, right? Because we want to test, like, a feature of the world. So in Bell test, we can just derive everything, and everything's really nice. So maybe the best we can do in this computational regime is reduce to some assumptions that we make in complexity theory, which are really, really well-founded. And I think the hardness of factoring is maybe not as well-founded as something that I'm going to get to in a second, like the collapse of the polynomial hierarchy or these sort of things. So really, I want to go down to the basics, like P and equal NP, or these sort of things that we really, really firmly believe in complexity theory. Yeah, thank you. I should also say, please interrupt me at any time with questions. Okay, so what we want is a scheme that's both feasible and, you know, as near term as possible, like on small quantum devices that are maybe still a bit noisy. Exactly. And at the same time, we want the task to be harder than anything that we can do on a classical computer, of course. And then I've tried to motivate that we really want, you know, a test. We want a certificate that in the end we've achieved the task that we wanted to do. okay, and what's it going to look like? Again, like, you know, I have some tester, you know, it's the person in the lab who puts switches, turns switches on the quantum device, and the quantum device spits out some classical outcomes, and then I want to compare these outcomes, do something with some classical post-processing to then produce a yes-no answer. Okay, and then I want to do this on a small quantum. Good. So now let me outline the talk. So I'm going to outline some candidates that we hope to achieve this task. Then I'm going to look at, you know, whether or how we can certify those schemes. And then look at, you know, if I actually want to practically do something, what can I do? Okay, so quantum sampling schemes are arguably something that's really naturally quantum. Like whenever I do a quantum measurement, I sample from a probability distribution. This is something that arguably is maybe much less natural on a classical computer, right? Where I really have to work really hard to put in classical randomness and then put that into some classical randomized algorithm. Okay, and the idea of the schemes that people have proposed, and I think Scott Aronson is one of the people who, you know, was first on that, is the following. So the scheme that Scott Aronson and Alex Arkhipov proposed called boson sampling, and the idea is that you take n photons in m linear optical modes, and then you send those photons through a linear optical interferometer. So, you know, just beam splitters and phase shifters. And then in the end, you measure a photon number. Okay, so it's really a very simple scheme. And the crucial part here is that you send those photons through a random unitary linear optical interferometer. Okay, so you draw a random task from some family, in this case, just a Haar random mode transformation. Then you send your photons through that random task, and then you measure the output distribution. Okay, so you have two notions of randomness here, right? So I draw a random task, and then the task is to sample from the output distribution of that task. Okay? All right, and I can do something very similar for qubits, right? Where now I just don't have an interferometer. I have some family of unitaries, which might be defined by quantum circuits, like, you know, universal quantum circuits, or maybe diagonal or IQP circuits. And in the end, I'm going to measure just in the computational basis, and the task is to sample from the output distribution. Good. Okay. And we do have an argument that these sort of tasks are hard for certain families of circuits. Okay, so the condition under which we have an argument is that it's sharply hard to approximate output probabilities within the family of circuits that we're looking at. Okay, so in the case of boson sampling, the neat thing is that the output probabilities are basically given by permanence. They're given by permanence of submatrices of this large unitary matrix that define my tasks. And permanence, we know, are sharply hard to approximate. And equally for universal random circuits, we also know that output probabilities are sharply hard to compute. And they need to be sharply hard to approximate up to a relative error. And this is something that we can also prove for all of those schemes that I showed you about. Okay, so now we want to leverage the hardness of computing something, computing output probabilities, to argue for hardness of something much weaker, right? Just to sample from the output distribution. Okay, so the way the proof works is basically that we suppose there was an efficient sampling algorithm for the output distribution of a randomly drawn unitary, and then we can construct an argument in the exact case, so when do something very unrealistic, namely exactly sample, which is based on what's called Stockmeyer's algorithm, which basically takes in as an input a classical sampler and then outputs probabilities. But it's an algorithm that lives in what's called the third level of the polynomial hierarchy. But on the other hand, we know that calculating probabilities is sharply hard. And we know that P to the sharp E contains the polynomial hierarchy. So if I have Stockmeyer's algorithm, which takes as an input a sampler, and then outputs probability in the third level of the hierarchy, but the probabilities are above the hierarchy, right? So computing probabilities is sharply hard. So that means the hierarchy collapses to the third level. So this is an unlikely consequence. Okay, and the same sort of argument we can do for approximate sampling, where approximate sampling is now in total variation distance. So I want to sample from a distribution that's close in total variation distance to my target distribution. And then we can run a similar argument under two additional, or with two additional assumptions or properties of the circuit family that we need to prove. One is average case hardness. So not only does it need to be hard to approximate these probabilities up to a relative error in the worst case, but also on average. So if I draw a random instance, it should be hard with some high probability, constant probability. And then in addition, we need that the output distribution anti-concentrates. And I'm going to get to what that means in a second. Okay? So this is the sort of main layout of the proof for quantum supremacy of these schemes. And if you want, I can go into more detail later, but I think suffice it to say this much for now. Do you have any questions about this? Yes? Okay. Cool. Okay, so let me delve a little bit into anti-concentration, because this is something that I'm going to need for a later part of the talk. Okay, so anti-concentration, by that we mean that the probability over the random choice of the unitary, right? So unitaries define the instance, that a fixed probability, so say, I don't know, you can just fix it to be the top left corner of the matrix or something, is larger than something that's proportional to the uniform distribution on the sample space, is larger than a constant. Okay? So it basically says that a constant fraction of the instances have high output probability. By high, I just mean larger than uniform. Okay? So how do we prove this? We can prove this for large families of circuits, namely two designs. And the basic idea of the proof is what's called the Paley-Zygmund inequality, which is like an anti-concentration variant of Markov's inequality, which all of you probably know. And what's key to this is that the probability that we're interested in here, so this probability needs to be a constant on the right-hand side, that this depends on the second moment of my circuit family. Okay, and for two designs, of course, we know what the second moments are, right? They are just the moments of the Haar measure. So these properties together give us that for two designs, we have anti-concentrations. Okay? And okay, so universal circuits are two designs. For IQP circuits, they are not two designs so far as I know, but we can at least bound the second moment, so yeah. So the message of the slide is basically anti-concentration is, you know, the output probabilities are reasonably large on a constant fraction of the instances. And the second message is two design properties, or second moments if you want, are the tool that you have to prove anti-concentration. Okay, so we can add to our proof slide second moment bounds as, you know, the thing that we need, or I don't know of any proof of anti-concentration that doesn't use second moment bounds. Yes, but, yeah, so in this, yeah, it's a bit of a confusing terminology. But in this context, anti-concentration is really a property of a fixed probability, so say the top left corner of a matrix, over the choice of the unitary. Okay? But we're going to get to a notion of anti-concentration, which you're referring to in a second. If you want, exactly, right? So I said in the beginning, we have two notions of randomness, right? We have the randomness of the choice of the unitary, and then fixing a unitary, we have, you know, the probability distribution from which we sample, which then, you know, I draw random samples. And these are, you know, anti-concentration lives here. Anti-concentration lives in where I draw random instances of unitaries. And this is also where the second moment, right? I scramble over the unitaries. I calculate the second moment over the unitaries. Okay. So much to proofs of quantum supremacy. Questions on this? No? Okay. Then let me come to the maybe more interesting part of the talk, namely the question of whether we can classically certify quantum supremacy schemes. Okay, so let me draw this picture again. We want to test that, you know, delegate some tasks. So the Y in this case is now we know what it is. We send a unitary through the quantum device. And then the quantum device spits out numbers. We also know what it is. It's samples from the distribution. Okay. So now, given the samples, I want some classical post-processing algorithm that produces a yes-no answer. Do the samples come from the correct distributions or not? Okay. And I'm going to make myself as easy as possible and give the test arbitrary classical computational power. So what I'm going to look at is just the question, how many samples do I need from the quantum device to verify that, you know, the samples come from the correct distribution that I intended it to be? Okay. So what do I mean by certification? I mean, I've already said it in words. So given samples from Q and an epsilon, which, you know, is how far the distributions are tolerated to be from one another, a target distribution P, then I want to decide whether the distribution Q from which the samples come is equal to P, or whether it's at least epsilon far away from P. Okay? Because it's I want to make my life as easy as possible again, and make the task that I want as easy as possible while still being meaningful. Okay, so here I have a very loose requirement, if you want, right? I only want to accept if the distribution is precisely the correct one, right? I only require the test to accept if the distribution is precisely the correct one, and the main requirement is just rejecting when the distribution is wrong. Okay, so now I could, of course, do something like you suggest, namely, you know, introduce like a second ball from the inside, right? So maybe introduce an epsilon 2, and then say, okay, if Q minus P is less than epsilon 2, then I accept. But this is a much harder task, right? Because in particular, it implies that I accept in this case. Then I don't care what the test does in this case. Well, I think it's equivalent to give myself a promise or to just say I don't care. In you mean the picture above? Yeah. Ah, no. I mean, I give it one unitary. I don't know. The matrix elements of the unitary. I don't know. It's just representing, you know, some input. Exactly. So now good point. So now I draw a random unitary, I fix it, I send it to the device, and then I want to certify that the distribution is correct. Okay. Good. Okay. And what we can show is that this is not possible with polynomially many samples. So the sample complexity for, you know, the most prominent schemes like boson sampling, universal circuit sampling, IQP circuit sampling, for all of those schemes, the minimal number of samples that you need to achieve the task I just showed you is something that scales as 2 to the n over 4 in the number of qubits. Okay? Yes. I'll get to that in a second. It's true for these schemes, and it will be true for all schemes that have second moments, which are very small. Large second moments, yeah. Exactly. So we're going to use, ingredients from the classical literature. But they are surprisingly recent. So, I mean, people have looked at this question of, you know, verifying classical distributions. But, you know, like, the definite answers are only from, like, a couple of years ago or so. So people have known for a long time that, you know, to verify the uniform distribution, for example, you always need a number of samples that scales as the square root of the sample space. So, I mean, this is also something I should say. This is really not a property of the hardness of the distribution. It's a property of the flatness of the distribution. Okay, so in particular, the uniform distribution is one that's really hard to certify. Okay, so let me give you a glimpse of how we prove this, and then also maybe answer Alexei's question. But before that, I should show you this picture. So if I have a boson sample, there's no test. Okay, but I want to get to the proof. Okay, so we start from the second moment bound. So second moment bound is what forbids classical certification. And this is a property, again, of the unitaries, like scrambling over the unitaries. Okay? So if you have small second moments, yeah, so small second moment means that the probabilities are concentrated around something that scales as 1 over the sample space. Okay? Okay, so if this is the case, and it is the case for the schemes that I just showed you, then we can make a statement about the distribution for a fixed unitary with high probability over the choice of the unitary. Okay? So what you can show is that if you have small second moments, then that implies that the probability distribution is also really flat. Okay, and how we do this is by using the fact that all Reni entropies with alpha larger than 1 are equivalent, up to constant factors, and Markov's inequality. Okay? And it's easy to see that, right? Because we can calculate the expectation value of the second Reni entropy from the second moment by just summing over the, you know, over the x's here. That gives me the expectation value of the second Reni entropy. And then we, you know, with Markov's inequality, we just get a large deviation bound from the expectation value. Okay, so what this shows is that the probability distribution of a fixed unitary is exponentially flat with high probability. Good. Okay, and from that, we can bound what's called the two-third norm, or the L two-third norm of the probability, the target probability distribution, in terms of the largest probability of the distribution. Okay, so 1 over the square root bounds this two-third norm. So what's the two-third norm? The two-third norm is, okay, so I take all elements of the probabilities distribution to the power of two-third, and then I cut out the tail of the distribution with weight epsilon and the largest element of the distribution. And as it turns out, this is the classical theorem that I refer to, this quantity is precisely what determines the sample complexity of black box certification. So this is a really curious fact, right? You have this strange P minus epsilon minus max two-third norm, which defines how many samples you need for these black box certification tests. Okay, and what we've shown is that the second moments, small second moments that we have for these quantum supremacy schemes give you a bound on this quantity, which is exponentially large. So in total, we have something, you know, a scaling that scales in the failure probability of the distribution being flat, the epsilon with respect to which we want to certify, and then something that's exponential in the number of qubits. Okay? Did you follow me on that, or everyone's very stunned? Okay. Good. Then let me make one more comment, which I've already said a little bit, right? So what this two-third norm also tells us is that, okay, so on the one hand, it tells us that very flat distributions are really hard to certify. But on the other hand, it tells us that very concentrated distributions are easy to certify. So if I just have polynomially many, you know, probabilities that are non-zero up to an epsilon tail, then I can verify in polynomially many samples. Okay? It's easy to see that, right? You can just estimate the probabilities up to small error, and then, you know, you can just you can verify it. Okay. So coming back to our proof picture, so this was the proof for hardness of quantum sampling schemes, right? So now what we've added is a proof for hardness of classical certification. Okay, and the second moment bound implied a high min entropy, right? So that the distribution of a fixed unitary was flat, which then in turn implied hardness of classical certification by this valiant and valiant result. Okay, and this is really something, you know, that you have to let sink in. So both hardness of verification and hardness of sampling require these second moment bounds, right? So the same property that allows you to prove hardness of sampling also allows you to prove hardness of verification. So this is really neat about this result. You had a question, Emma? Well, the concentrated, I would call the concentrated case the sparse case. So where you, I mean, yeah. No, no, it just, no, no. No, when I draw these distributions, I just, you know, I put them in descending order. I just put the probabilities in descending order. So this is really the sparse case. And I come to that in now, actually. Okay, so we can, you know, draw this landscape a little bit further. And one really neat example for this are IQP circuits, because we have a lot of results on those circuits because they are really simple. Okay, so now I'm coming precisely to your question, right? So for IQP circuits, you know, in the case where the distributions are really flat, we have a hardness argument, right? We have anti-concentration, and that gives us hardness of classical sampling. Whereas in the sparse case, we don't have a hardness argument, right? When we don't have anti-concentration, so for families of IQP circuits that don't anti-concentrate, we don't have a hardness argument. Yes? No, so this is confusing, right? So now I'm looking at, you know, fixed probability distributions. Okay, so for anti-concentration, again, we were looking at scrambling over the instances, right? So over the unitaries. And there we looked at, you know, one matrix element, but then scrambling over the unitaries. And then this property implied that for any fixed unitary, with high probability, the distribution is going to be flat. Jumping ahead, exactly. We do have an easiness argument for IQP circuits, namely in cases where we have very concentrated, sparse IQP distributions. We have a classical algorithm by Martin Schwarz and Martin van der Nest, which, you know, does the sampling efficiently. So we actually do have an easiness argument in these cases. So for very sparse IQP distributions, we have an efficient classical sampling algorithm. Whereas for very anti-concentrated flat distributions, we don't have a hardness, we don't have a classical algorithm, and we have a hardness algorithm. Okay, and now the verification results that we added are the same, right? So in the concentrated case, the sparse case, we have a verification algorithm, just compute the probabilities from the samples, and then compare. Whereas in the very flat, exponentially flat case, there we have a no-go for classical. We require exponentially many samples of classical verification. Okay, so now, of course, the interesting question is, what's the ground in the middle, right? So is there some ground in the middle where maybe I can have classical certification, but still the hardness argument kicks in, or is that not possible? But yeah, these are really hard questions that I don't have an answer to. Okay, do you have any question about classical certification? I think I know what you're referring to, and I'm going to get to it in a second. Yes, please. Yes. That's a very good question. That's a good question. Yeah, so I'm... It's not clear, right? So it's conceivable that you have anti-concentration, right? Even though you don't have a second moment bound, right? So I said second moment bounds allow you to prove anti-concentration, but it's so conceivable that you have anti-concentration without a second moment bound, okay? So in this case, you could have anti-concentration, but no high min entropy, right? So, I mean, you know, you can artificially, you know, put a lot of probability in probability weight in like a few probabilities. That doesn't ruin anti-concentration, but it ruins the high min entropy property. Okay, and then you would have to go again in the details of this two-third norm and see how this will scale in these cases. But I don't think there's an easy answer to that question. Yes. What kinds of conditions would you like to relax? Yes. So yeah, I would just give the same answer as I gave to Yikai's question, maybe. So, so you don't need the second moment bound for anti-concentration necessarily, right? So. So, and in particular, high min entropy and anti-concentration don't always come along with one another, right? So you can have anti-concentration without a high min entropy. So in this sense, you can relax, you know, the requirements. I don't have an example of a family of circuits that is anti-concentrated and doesn't have high min entropy. So all the examples that I know of, which for which we know anti-concentration, they are via just proving second moment bounds. This is not true, actually. So there's a model, the DQC1 model, which, I don't know. The idea is you have one qubit which is pure and many qubits which are maximally mixed. And for that model, you can come up with an argument like this as well. And in this model, you can very directly prove anti-concentration. So that's a case, actually, where we don't have a second moment bound, what we know of anti-concentration. That's a good question. It might. yes. Yeah, I guess you need to, you know, restrict yourself to some model such that you can at least efficiently specify the distribution. But yeah, I guess maybe it might be yourself even more power or less constraints or something. But I don't know. Okay. Then let me come in the last, I don't know how much time do I have actually? 45 minutes? No, I mean it. Okay, cool. No, that's perfect. I don't have as much material. Okay, so now that we know that we cannot classically certify quantum sampling schemes, what can we do? Okay, so we want to open the black box. Okay, so I want to just, you know, present to you some schemes that people have come up with, which are maybe practical, make some assumptions, and, you know, maybe just paint a bit of a panorama of what kind of methods are out there. Okay, so the first kind of methods, they just look at the very same type of scheme that I've looked at in the classical certification. Okay, so everything's classical. I just, you know, delegate my computation with just sending my device the unitary and then receive samples from the device. Okay, so now there are two main approaches that I know of under which or using which you can actually sample efficiently verify. You still can't do it computationally efficiently, right? So remember at the beginning I said we allow ourselves arbitrary classical computational power. So we're just looking at the number of samples that we need. And in these cases, we can get the number of samples to polynomial, but we still need exponential classical computational power. Okay, so the first one is what's called HOG. So it's a proposal by Scott Aronson and Lia Chen. And the idea is that what's really hard about these schemes is to produce samples from distributions that are larger than the median. And then they say, this is our conjecture. Our conjecture is, what's hard about quantum sampling schemes, it's hard to produce samples that are larger than the median of the distribution. Okay, and this is not such an unreasonable conjecture, but it's, I don't know, it's very ad hoc. But if you're willing to accept this conjecture, then it's obvious how to verify sample efficiently, right? You can sample efficiently, I mean, you can compute the median of the distribution, you know, on a classical computer, right? You can just compute some probabilities at random and then estimate the median up to polynomially small accuracy. And then, you know, you receive samples from your device. You compute the probability of obtaining the sample from the ideal distribution, and then you compare to the median. And then, you know, I don't know, if more than half are larger than the median, you're happy, and if not, you know, you're not. So this is really a very simple verification scheme based on, you know, what I would call like a tailor-made complexity conjecture for quantum. Another suggestion, which which has come out of the Google group and which Adam and Bill have looked at also last year, is what's called cross-entropy verification. So here the idea is that rather than trying to estimate or to verify total variation distance directly, I can try and verify cross-entropy. I can try and estimate the cross-entropy between the ideal distribution and the samples that I got from my quantum device. And I can do that from just something that scales polynomially in the number of qubits, many samples. Okay, because you have a sum, you just estimate, you just get probabilities. Again, you get samples, then you compute probabilities, and you can estimate this sum by just computing the empirical mean of the log of P of X over the samples that you got. Okay, so now you could say, okay, what does that have to do with total variation distance? But you can actually show that under a certain condition on the noisy distribution, so on the real distribution in your quantum device, the cross entropy provides a bound to the total variation distance. And what's the condition? The condition is that the entropy of the noisy distribution is larger than the entropy of the ideal distribution. So basically, this is a condition on the kind of noise that's happening in your quantum device. So you make an assumption on the noise in your quantum device. Okay, and maybe we just have a brief look at the proof, because it's very simple. You apply Pinsker's inequality, which bounds the total variation distance. Okay, so Pinsker's inequality just bounds total variation distance by cross entropy minus the entropy of the noisy distribution. Okay. Then you apply your condition, entropy of noisy distribution is larger than entropy of ideal distribution, and that directly gives you the bound on the total variation distance in terms of the cross entropy. To measure the total variation distance in general.
Yeah.
Oh, what do you mean by, yeah, exactly. No, exactly, precisely, because, we need this condition on the entropy of the distribution. So, yeah, it just doesn't work in general. Yeah, you have questions about this? Well, I mean, okay, so the Google people, they, they bring out a large machinery of an argument why this assumption is met in their experiment. Although, I mean, in their experiment, they don't do precisely this, but something that's only related. Something that's related, but, they consider the type of noise they expect in their experiment and everything, and then come up with an argument why this assumption is met. But I don't know. Adam and Bill, who came up with this argument, they're just like, well, I don't know. So, and I don't really know. I mean, if you have depolarizing noise, for example, the assumption is met. But yeah, exactly. It's global depolarizing noise. I mean, yeah. Okay, good. Let me go on to what I call like interactive schemes. Okay, so the schemes we've looked at so far always require, I send my unitary to the device, I receive samples. Okay, but I can imagine interactive schemes. So when I send my unitary, I receive samples, then I send a response to the samples, I receive something again, and so on. Right. So if I allow for interaction, then we actually know that we can verify arbitrary computation under some cryptographic assumptions. So this is Omila Mahadev's result from last year. And then for the case of IQP circuit, and this is probably what you were referring to before, Abhinav, right? We actually have a scheme that does something very similar. So the idea there is that under some cryptographic assumption, we can verify IQP circuits just from the samples. And the basic idea is that I modify my distribution over IQP circuits in such a way that I hide a certain secret within the distribution. Okay, so I bias my distribution towards a certain vector of samples. And then I can check from the samples whether, those samples are towards that vector or in another direction. And that, that construction is also based on codes and exactly, being able to hide stuff. Yeah. Yes, I know. Yeah. Although, I haven't read everything in much detail. But was it like rigorously broken, or was it just, I thought it was just practically broken. I mean, the guy came up with an algorithm, you know, that did it for large instances. So, yeah. No, I think I would insist that I'm not opening the box. I'm not opening the box. I mean, I allow myself to, you know, have some knobs on the box. You know, I'm allowed to suggest different unitaries. But I'm not opening the box yet. This is still device independent in this sense. Okay? So I just still, you know, put in classical instructions and receive classical stuff. Well, I mean, yeah, maybe it's much harder, right? Because I mean, it's much more requirement on the quantum device because, you know, I want many rounds of interactions. I want many more knobs or so. So I mean, it just puts a larger burden on. Yeah, that's a good question. Off the top of my head, I would say yes, because it can certify states. And once it can certify states, it can also certify something. But yeah, this is something that... Good. OK, but we can also open the box. OK, so we can look inside and say, OK, I have a computer. And that computer has gates, and that computer has measurements. And I can individually certify gates, I can individually certify measurements, and then put everything together, assuming that nothing bad happens in between, and that could also give me a certificate that nothing went wrong. This is, you know, sort of the most bottom-up approach that you can imagine. Like, rather than doing top-down, just doing everything device independently, I just have a black box and I push some knobs and pull some levers. I look inside the box and I, you know, do the dirty verifying every gate and then scale this up, or make an assumption that everything composes well. So, yeah. So I basically use my knowledge of the device. So this might be something reasonable, you know, if you actually have a device in your lab and you know what's going on, rather than if you send your stuff to Google or IBM and they do it for you and give you results. Yeah, that's a, I mean, yeah, in, to some extent, yes. But to some extent, I mean, you're basically putting the large scale into the assumption that everything composes well, right? Yeah, exactly. But maybe you can also do something in between, namely, you know, consider large parts of your quantum device as a black box, but then have maybe only very small parts, which, you know, you can control very well. Like, for example, quantum measurements. So say you have like well-trusted single-qubit measurements, then we can show that, you know, you can actually estimate the fidelity of, you know, the output state. So now we have, you know, the black box is now not a classical device, but a quantum state preparation. And then the task is to verify the state preparation. And let me go into a little bit of detail for that, because it's something that I've also worked on. And the idea there is, you know, now I want to go from verifying state preparations to verifying distributions, classical distributions. And how we do that is we, you know, we go from trace distances to total variation distances. Okay, because we know that for every measurement, the trace distance can be pinched to total variation distance such that it gives a bound on the total variation distance of the outcome distribution in any measurement basis. Okay, so bounds on the trace distance bound you the total variation distance. So we can, you know, try and estimate the trace distance. Now, often it's much easier to estimate the fidelity, which also via Fuchs and Van der Graaf gives you bounds on the total variation distance. They are quite loose bounds, and this is a problem sometimes, but they are bounds. So, I mean, at least on an in principle level, by estimating or verifying fidelity, you can estimate or verify total variation. Okay. So one idea, which is quite neat, I find, is the notion of fidelity witnesses. Okay, so the idea is I want to do, you know, the simplest thing I can imagine. Namely, I just want a witness such that, so a witness is an operator that I measure on my quantum state. So remember, the quantum state is what we want to verify now. So it's an operator on my quantum state that I measure. So I compute the expectation value of that operator. And then I compare the result to some threshold value, okay? And that threshold value defines a hyperplane through state space, okay? And then if my operator is, you know, constructed in a nice fashion and my state, you know, satisfies certain properties such as, for example, that it lies in a nice corner of state space, right? So that when I cut state space with a hyperplane, everything that's on the one side is always close to this target state. Then maybe this I can use to verify the state. And we can come up with a very simple example of that. Namely, if you have the ground state of a Hamiltonian with a gap, then you can come up with a witness operator, which is just 1 minus the Hamiltonian divided by the gap. So you basically just need to measure the energy of a quantum state in order to compute the expectation value of this witness operator. Okay? And then we can show that, you know, this bounds the fidelity. So this witness operator actually bounds the fidelity. So ground states of Hamiltonian actually lie in these, you know, low dimensional corners of state space. Okay, and this is really neat because we can very easily construct such witnesses for given quantum states. So say we have some unitary and we apply it to a reference state. Now we want to construct a witness operator for this state. Then we start from a witness for the reference state, the all zero state, which is just the Hamiltonian, which consists of minus z's on every individual qubit. Okay, but then nothing changes in terms of the energy and everything if I apply a unitary to the state and at the same time I conjugate the Hamiltonian with that unitary. Okay, so this Hamiltonian, where I just have a sum of z's and I conjugate those z's with the unitary that I apply to my state, witnesses the quantum state. Okay, so in particular, if I have a constant depth circuit, then this Hamiltonian is still a local Hamiltonian, and I can hope to measure it easily. And what we've come up with a scheme which, marries precisely these features. Okay, so it's a constant depth circuit, which at the same time is hard to sample from and efficiently verifiable, okay, by precisely this witness idea. Okay, and the idea is basically that you do like a space-time mapping, right? So rather than having a circuit in 1D and have it in time, you just map everything to space. So now you have a 2D grid or so of qubits, and you apply a constant depth circuit. And then, there's the idea of measurement-based computation, which tells you that if I measure sequentially on this grid, then that it effectively implements a quantum circuit, a universal quantum circuit on the remaining dimension. Here I've opened the box to the extent that I trust my single qubit measurements. It's reasonable, yeah, but at the same time, I think Abhinav's concern also kicks in, because all I'm doing is I'm doing 2-qubit gates and single qubit measurements. So in some sense, I mean, everything I'm doing is local, but still somehow the global property that arises from these local things makes things hard again. So yeah, it's really magic. Okay, and certification is of course now possible with just these star operators that from graph states. Okay, you have questions on this? Yeah, that's true. No, that's true. I think it applies to some extent in that. I think you're right. It doesn't apply. Yeah. Okay, once you try, yeah, but I mean. Yeah, that's true. But then, I mean, on the other hand, so trusting single qubit measurements means also trusting single qubit unitaries, right? But then, I mean, single qubit unitaries is all I put in as hardness, right? So, yeah, I mean, it's a bit funny, but I mean, this is, where you can push it in some sense. Okay, so let me summarize. My 15 minutes are over. Okay, so first, I tried to convince you of this, that this sort of scheme is, a good idea of how you can perform a computational Bell test. I send some unitary to my device, I receive some results, and then I want to test. So that's the idea of a computational database. Okay, then I showed you that if you have boson sampling or universal circuit sampling, all of these sampling schemes, verification in this sort of setup is not possible with just polynomially many samples. Okay, and then just now I've shown you that you know, if I trust my quantum measurements, then a very simple scheme can be constructed, which then again gives you a test, which is not only sample efficient, but also computationally efficient. Okay, thank you very much. Yes, yes. I'm still not sure if I would say that it's then fully device independent. Because, I mean, okay, so you can do that, right? You can verify your measurements. But then you still have to make the assumption that, you know, putting the measurement on the quantum state is actually, you know, actually works well. And putting like every, you know, I have to do many measurements on the same quantum state. And all of them have to work correctly at the same time. So, you know, I would say this helps me to build up trust in, you know, correct working of my measurement, but I'm not sure if this, you know, gives you full device independence. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. 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 No, please. Good question. Yeah, I mean, it depends on your, you know, on the level of your skepticism that you had beforehand. I mean, if you weren't a skeptic to begin with, then I think this, you know, won't draw the needle. But, you know, if you were somewhat skeptical that, you know, quantum computers could be built, then this might, then this makes it really hard for you to still be a skeptic. not that I know of. And also, I mean, there's not so many skeptics around, right? So. Really, really.